This is a story about an invisible hand guiding the economy. No, not the invisible hand of self-interest that Adam Smith wrote about in The Wealth of Nations. This invisible hand is much more modern. It's that artificial intelligence we keep hearing so much about. Our special contributor, Larry Summers, is a macroeconomist who also sits on the board of OpenAI. Who better to ask what AI could mean for Adam Smith's economy?
My guess is that this is going to raise the neutral rate of interest over time, both because of the massive investment that's going to need to take place in data centers and because of the acceleration in the rate of growth. So I think the so-called R star is likely to be higher, perhaps even considerably higher, because of AI. I think it's possible that it's going to be a disinflationary force because of acceleration of productivity growth, as the internet was during the 1990s.
The economic potential of AI varies widely, with some saying that it can disrupt jobs, whole industries, and even pose existential challenges.
It's not yet like replacing jobs in the way or to the degree that people thought it was going to. Of course, jobs will change, and of course, some jobs will totally go away.
It really is an existential threat. Some people say this is just science fiction, and until fairly recently, I believed it was a long way off. Now I think it's quite likely that sometime in the next 20 years, these things will get smarter than us, and we really need to worry about what happens then.
So let me ask about one particular, perhaps rule of thumb or rule, and that is the relationship between inflation on the one hand and unemployment on the other, which has been an important issue for the Federal Reserve, for example, with its dual mandate to address both of those. Do you think it could change that relationship?
It certainly could, and you can make arguments in both directions. Perhaps the more flexible economy means that rates of inflation or prices will be more sensitive to demand and unemployment than they were before. Perhaps the more rapid underlying productivity growth will mean that there's less sensitivity, because when there's an increase in demand, the economy will be able to accommodate it more easily because there's more capacity fundamentally in the economy. I think it's difficult to know, and if I had to guess, the effects that I described on the neutral interest rate and so forth are probably going to be more salient than any change in the slope of the Phillips curve of that relationship you referred to between inflation and unemployment. But nobody can be confident in their judgments about this kind of thing.
There's the uncertainty about what AI could mean for the economy, but there are also questions about what it could mean for central banks trying to set monetary policy and how it could change the way they gather and analyze data about the economy. Sascha Steffen of the Frankfurt School of Finance has studied the ways AI might change monetary policy transmission.
Specifically, and this is also the most common or most natural thing people are thinking about here, is it will improve forecasting. And I think this is sort of where everybody's interested. How are interest rates going? How does the economy develop going forward? How is inflation going forward? So here we're going to see a lot already happening in terms of AI. And I think here there's also a lot to learn going forward.
Is it likely to make forecasting more accurate, do you think?
I think definitely. So I think one dimension of AI is basically increasing the toolbox and the methodologies, improving on the methodologies, thereby also making forecasting much more precise. Also basically using models to use existing data and use them in completely novel ways, right? So how can we use bond market data? How can we use loan market data? So we can employ these models to look at things that we haven't been able to do before. We can look at websites. We can use images from satellites. We can use social media, right? So actually, I have a study, a recent one, in which we try to use AI and Twitter, or X, in order to generate an index about what do individuals, like households, have an idea about how inflation is going to develop going forward. right? So this is what we call inflation expectations. And this is something where central banks, the Federal Reserve, but also the European central banks are looking much more closely at compared to what we call like realized inflation, what we have. So what do actually people, households expect in terms of inflation going forward? Because this is going to affect how they're going to behave. What kinds of products are they going to buy? What kinds of how they're going to save going forward. And also firms are going to be affected by that because they see if customers don't buy, the shelves are going to remain full and they basically report a completely different bottom or top line going forward.
What are the risks of expanding out the data that way? I mean, large language models by and large are based on what human beings have generated, and human beings are not perfect. And you can get hallucinations that way. What are the risks, particularly as you go to things like social media, for example, X?
Information sensitivity is always run, right? Which means that if new information arises, that can cause maybe a complete meltdown of the market, stocks are going to be sold. And of course, AI makes it even more likely that these risks are actually, or these new information is actually going to emerge. Right, but also another risk is, for example, interconnectedness. And AI also will connect institutions more going forward. There might be shared data, there might be shared platforms that might increase interconnectedness. So if one domino drops, the others might actually drop as well. So amplification of existing risks is definitely one problem. Another problem that's very frequently mentioned if you talk to practitioners in this field is also a kind of what we call model bias, right? So what happens if we use data that has been generated by a model that has already been false to begin with, and then we continue to use that data going forward? There will be so-called like perpetuation of these biases going forward, and like garbage in, garbage out.
We hear from some experts in AI that we're getting to a point, maybe past a point, where we don't actually know how it works. It's a black box in that sense. Yeah. If that's true, how can a central bank rely on it? How can it verify it or certify it to make sure that it's making correct inferences?
That's an absolute important point. This is, on the one hand, this is definitely a risk, right? Because if things go wrong, the question, the trust that might be there quickly goes away, and then the things might even be worse going forward. One of the potential powerful applications of AI for central banks is to not replace necessarily, but to complement the professional forecasting that that the central banks usually rely on. They usually do on a quarterly basis, ask a lot of professionals and investment banks and other institutions as to what do they expect the economy to develop going forward, specifically when it comes to inflation. And now it might be actually possible to set up an AI model that exactly does that. So it basically, it is trained on the individual. It's trained on the CVs of the professional forecasters, how they have actually voted or what they have done in previous forecasts that they did. What is their job? What they learned? And then asked the model instead of the forecaster. And the existing research already tells us that there's a high degree of overlap in terms of what the professional forecast actually would tell him or herself and what the model actually sells, right? But then the one risk, and now coming back to your question, is that how can we actually make sure that the model actually uses only the information that is available at the time of the forecast itself, or is it trained basically on information that it should not know because it actually happened afterwards?
Well, I wonder about the systemic risk, because not being a computer science, it's possible that AI could spot relationships that otherwise humans might miss. I mean, so you have something like Silicon Valley Bank in the United States. Is it possible AI would have spotted imbalances earlier that humans missed?
Specifically with Silicon Valley Bank, it would have recognized this, because it's also interesting that people did not realize this because it was obvious, to be clear, because actually all the publicly available data was pointing exactly at that. But no, you're absolutely right. So these kind of systemically important banks, also other banks, risks emerging based on, for example, liquidity consideration might be detected much, much earlier compared to what a regulator or supervisor might actually see.
And what we need human beings, economists presumably, to check what's going on, to make corrections, because you can have hallucinations in any model, and if you don't correct them, as I understand it, they just compound.
I think this is exactly one danger, that people might actually try to and rely on AI and these models too much and think, okay, these models actually know what's going to happen. But the idea how to assess these outcomes or these outputs, that is a crucial one. And this means, I think also for us as not only as economists, but also as educators, we need to make sure that people understand the underlying theory and economics actually in order to evaluate, is that what the model actually tells me? Is this something that's actually plausible or something that's not, right? So I think this puts a lot of pressure on us also as educators, but then also on the different institutions, do they actually train the people right going forward?